Hello, everybody. This is Vince Hefner, your pastor at the First Baptist Church in Cherville. Thankful that you've tuned in to be a part of our Bible study today. I want to share with you out of Psalm 81. What happens when you have burdens, difficulties, and hardships? Do you accept them and say, well, that's just the way life is? Or do you look about a change? The writer of Psalm 81 was going through some troubles and trials. He looked back into the history of his people, and he looked at a specific problem when the Hebrew people were in Egypt, and they were under the oppression of the Pharaoh. The Bible talks about having your shoulder to the wheel of burden, carrying a basket, which would be like mud to be able to make the bricks. But God gave them an answer. So as what we're going through right now and today, I want you to think about this passage of Scripture. It says this, Psalm 81, starting at verse 6. I removed his shoulder from the burden. His hands were freed from the baskets. You called in trouble, and I delivered you. I answered you in the secret place of thunder. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. And it says Selah, which means, what do you think about that? Hear, O my people, and I will admonish you. O Israel, if you listen to me, there shall be no foreign god among you. Neither shall you worship any foreign god. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. That was Psalm 81, verses 6 through 10. Now, the psalmist was pointing back in history at a time that's recorded in Scripture where the Hebrew people were in trouble. I mean, they were slaves to the Pharaoh. And for like 400 plus years, there they were. But they continually cried out to the Lord because of the trouble. And in chapter 81 of Psalms, the psalmist says, God gave them an answer. He removed the burdens from them. The idea of having a burden upon you, the idea of carrying that basket. God says, I'm going to remove that. I'm going to put you in a wonderful place, in a wonderful location. He says, I'm going to answer your prayers. It's a wonderful thing when God answers a prayer in your life, especially what we're going through now as a world. I think we need to step back and value this time that we have in seclusion, if you will, and think about all the prayers that God has answered in your life. Don't let those pass you by. You know, write those down and see how God has been proven over and over again. That's what the psalmist was doing in Psalm 81. He was looking back in his own history of his people, and he said, there was a time when we had trouble, but God answered our trouble. He mentions something in verse 8 again when he says, hear, O my people, and I will admonish you. And what God is saying is, I want you to listen to what I'm saying. One of the most aggravating things is when you're talking to someone and they're not paying attention or they're not listening. What they're kind of saying is what you say doesn't have any value. So when God is saying, oh, listen, oh, hear, O Israel, what he's saying is pay attention. I have something to say. O Israel, if you will listen to me, there shall be no foreign god among you. Now, I've been going to church since I was a child, and I've always heard people talk about how people had lost their way, how the church had lost its way. They're probably right to a certain regard. We look around, and even at our best times, most churches are half full or three quarters full. There's some that are doing well, but for the most part, people look around and say, well, where's everybody at on Sunday? And there's always these excuses. Well, this young family, they're going, and it's a sporting event. Or if you have a little financial assistance, you're able to go to the beach. Or people put other things in front of their way. Well, the nation of Israel had no travel teams, no travel ball. They didn't have a beach house. But they still had something in their way. Our problem is not activities. Our problem is indifference to God. The Hebrew people didn't want to listen to what God had to say. Till they got into trouble. And when they got into trouble, they could have accepted it, or they could have cried out to God and said, we need your help. God hears our prayers. God said this, I'll listen to you and I'll answer your prayer, but I want you to know something. There can be nothing between your soul and me. Now, you can put whatever is idol that you want to put there, but God is saying there can be nothing between me and you. It's kind of what Jesus said when they asked him, what's the greatest commandment? And Jesus said, well, I'll kind of tell you too. The first one is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. I think today in the society in which we live, for some people, it's a fearsome time. For me, it's a reflective time. It's a great opportunity to get alone with God and to look back at my life and the life of my people and say, God, you have answered our prayers. You have always been there for us. It's a time to evaluate and say, God, is there something in my life that shouldn't be there? And it's so easy to talk about somebody else's sin. It's easy to get up and preach about things that don't affect us. And I just pray always that, Lord, I hope I detest my sin as much as I detest everybody else's sin. It's easy to get up and talk about things that you don't have or things that you don't do. But Lord, let me be mindful of my own shortcomings. And I want to make sure there's nothing in my life that shouldn't be there. But God promises us this, there can be nothing between us and him. We can't have that. Whether it's indifference, whether it's possessions, whether it's position, doesn't make any difference. We cannot put anything between us and God. And I think this is a great time as a world that we say, God, you have to be number one in our lives. You have to be the first and most important thing in our lives. He says, not only can you have anything not there, but the last part of verse 9 says, nor shall you worship any foreign God. Things that are alien to us. We can't put anything in front of the Lord. Why? Because I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. What he's saying is, God can satisfy it. It's like eating a meal. Sometimes we'll eat something and we want something else 20 minutes later. It didn't satisfy. What God is saying is that when you're with me, I'll fill you and you will be satisfied. The goal is always the same, to make sure God is in the right place in our hearts. Years ago, I pastored a church up in Marshall, North Carolina, which is above Asheville. And our church had bought some property to relocate our church. We were downtown and we're just one street in Marshall, but we were going to move up on the bypass. And we bought like 28 acres of land, beautiful property. But right on that land, right on 2570, was this big barn. It was served as a kind of a tobacco barn. Also, they kept livestock in it. But when we bought it, it was ours. And on the side of that barn, this big, huge barn, was this tin metal that went across it. And in handwriting, you know, done by hand, it was the phrase, get right with God, and then it had a cross on it. It was painted in red. And like you say, it was done by an individual. It wasn't professionally done. But for years, that big barn stood up there. And there was that statement, get right with God. Now, one of the tough things that we had to do when we bought the land was we had to remove that barn. And I remember the mixed emotions I had, because that sign, as primitive as it was accurate. Get right with God. What a great testimony. I want you to know that no matter what your troubles are, God has the answer. He can remove that burden from your shoulder, and he can remove that basket, that burden that you have to carry. However, we have to put him first. He has to be Lord of Lords and King of Kings in our hearts. And I think once we believe that, then we're going to live it. And when the world sees Christians acting like Christians, then I think the Holy Spirit's going to be able to use us to reach other people. Now, this is Vince Hefner, your pastor at the First Baptist Church in Cherville. Thank you for tuning in, and pray that God blesses you in abundant ways through these challenging times. God bless.